Final day? Friday, December 30.
Right. What will that day be like?
Oh, I could use the word bittersweet. Obviously, this place and I have grown together. I've loved the work for a very long time. It will be hard leaving the building for the last time. But, you know, I also know and feel in my heart that it's the right time for a number of reasons. So while there'll be some angst, I'm prepared and ready to do it, you know. I took a long time to make this decision, and so I have no regrets.
You're a political science major, you're a history major, which is a great combination. You go to law school. What did you decide to work in the legislature
like a lot of second and third year law students, you know, you start to look for a job. As it turned out, my senior year of law school, I had an internship with the Judiciary Committee at the time, and Chairman Roland Ludge, great guy, good legislator, and worked on some things. I found the work exciting, interesting. I thought it was good work. I thought it was big stuff that needed to get done, and Roland was very kind to me, mentored me, and it just kind of got in the blood. And so I spent 1975-76, working part-time for the committee as one of the committee lawyers, and it was, I really enjoyed the work. I enjoyed the people. The work was both stimulating and important. Found value in that. And then, just by a series of unforeseen circumstances, was elected assistant clerk and then moved into the clerk's job in December of 77, when my predecessor resigned to go do other things.
What was your interpretation of what the clerk's role was?
Kind of manager of the process, you know. I'm trying to make sure that things, that first of all, the legislature's doing the things properly per the Constitution that they need to do. So I would find myself advising leadership about a number of those kinds of things. The role has changed, it's grown. The office is now responsible for a lot more things, the technology center, the public information office, all of those operations are under the clerk's office. So it's changed, but the work is fundamentally the same, and that is to support the legislature and its business and try and make sure they're doing things in a way that's both predictable to the public and keeps the public informed as to what's happening here.
The sanctity of the, when
did that become? Oh, you know, that was an easy one for me to gravitate towards. From my perspective, Jerry Warner, who was in the legislature when I got here and was here until he died in 97, taught me that. I mean, he taught me to respect the place and to care for the place. And he, to my mind, was the greatest legislator that's ever served, and that includes a lot of legislators in a lot of states because I've had the opportunity to meet lots of people. So he kind of instilled in me this sense that the institution is bigger than all of us and that it's important to nurture it, care for it, protect it where you can. You can't always, political things are always complicated, involved, and arouse great emotions in people. But if you try and instill a respect for what's happening here, I think that serves not only the public interest, but the legislature institutionally's best interest too. So I've always tried to do that. It's a role I've enjoyed. I've been able to, I think, help in some instances. So that's been rewarding.
Have you ever come down to a procedure that somebody was trying to pull that stumped you?
Well, I don't know about stump me. It's certainly there are times when I had to grate my teeth. I generally respect members trying to accomplish a public policy goal. But for people who come in just to destroy or attack and accomplish very little, that's not the way to operate in my mind. So if you're here to do some serious work and some serious business, fine. Well, there's latitude for you to get things done. But if your mission is to destroy and attack an institution like this, then, you know, I don't want to say you're going to irritate me, but I don't think it's good for the place, nor do I think it's good for government generally and how people interact with it. I mean, these are troubled times around the country right now. As you know, there's a lot of people distressed about things and governmental institutions that seem to be under attack. Some of that may be warranted, but I think the vast majority of it is not. The legislature has always been a convenient political punching bag, and that's unfortunate, but it's also just part of the deal. We started that in the early 80s. There was a big class that came in the 81 election, and the 79 and 81 elections, big classes for pre-term limit legislature. And it became pretty clear, and leadership recognized that. I went to them with some ideas about how we might approach some training. If nothing else, familiarizing people with the environment that they were now going to become part of. And it's just grown from there. I mean, I'm pretty proud of what we've been able to do in that regard. I think members gain valuable information who come to that program. I think it's been helpful and useful.
What's the one message that you try to impart to these new lawmakers as they come?
To think first and foremost about the institution. It's easy to come in and attack the place or attack other members, but by doing that, they belittle themselves. They need to take time to understand that the legislature is bigger than any one member or any accumulation of 49 members. It will be here long after they're gone. And I think it's important for the public to have some appreciation for what happens here, because everything we do here affects their lives. And I think they understand that. And I think it's important that we try and present an organized, rational perspective and basis in our decision making, in the legislature's decision making. So I hope that's what members take.
So you're cruising along and all of a sudden term limits comes in.
Yeah. Well, I am not a champion of term limits. I think it's been devastating to this institution because it takes time to grow. It takes time to learn. You know, this is a big business when you think about government in that context. So to expect somebody to come in and be a fully knowledgeable, aware, know what questions to ask kind of member, that just takes time. And term limits has taken that away from us. So now that members come in, they're immediately worried about their next election, which will be their last election. That's okay. Members worry about elections, but that shortness of time that they have in the environment, I think, has not done well in terms of members fully grasping some of their responsibilities and some of the nuances involved with state government and all the issues that they deal with.
One of the things that's kind of developed was the maybe your presence up there. And as media, felt that presence more than once when my phone went off.
Yeah, yeah. No, I did that on purpose. Yeah. You know, I can't tell you when I first noticed it. I know when I'm not happy about something that may be happening on the floor, not necessarily the debate, but how it's either being conducted or ancillary activities are going around. Because it was important at one time to listen to one another in the chamber and listen to the debate and the discussion and be respectful of one another. We've moved away from that some. I don't think floor debate today moves people the way it used to. But you still have to provide the opportunity and the environment for members to be able to interact and listen to one another and hopefully make good decisions. So if I helped in stabilizing things or calming the environment, that's great. I'm happy about that. I'm proud of that. I never tried to be too difficult for people to work with, but sometimes, you know, somebody needs to be a traffic cop in there, and I guess I did that role sometimes.
Some of the stories, maybe you can lay these to rest. Did you ever stop the clock at midnight?
No. Came close once, but never happened here. It has happened in other states, but never in Nebraska.
Never in Nebraska?
No.
Really? Did you ever call anybody in for the state patrol call the house?
Oh, yeah, that's happened two or three times. That's never much fun. There was a time in the, I'm trying to think, well, the year I was assistant clerk, which was 1977, the house was under call. It seemed like an eternity. It was probably an hour or two. We were looking for members who had been excused to come back. It turned out there were three or four that were traveling domestically around the country. But as those things tend to happen, it broke eventually, and we ended the day getting done what we needed to get done. But yeah, that stuff happens, but it doesn't happen often, thank God. There are mechanisms for getting the members here, but you don't like to see them used often because, you know, people have lives to live too, and they have things going on in their lives. And you hope that the members who are there are acting responsibly and doing the right thing and just not being stubborn because of some policy outcome that may come.
Now, people have said your influence goes beyond just the state of the legislature. Why was it important for you to become so involved in the national organization?
Because I learned. I've met a lot of wonderful people. There's an organization that people like I belong to. We meet annually. The legislature belongs to two national organizations, the National Conference of State Legislatures and the Council of State Governments. I met lots of wonderful legislators there. I learned a lot. You know, I think anytime you can get involved in an organization and the work that they're doing, you're going to be better prepared to do the work at home. I always felt that was the case for me. I was fortunate enough to get in leadership, and I just enjoyed the work. You know, you enjoy spending time with people who share similar problems and similar stories and similar joys. So that was always very enjoyable experience for me.
Now, I would say Nebraskans will probably watch the coverage ETV or
right.
Nebraska Public Media. You'll
right.
Probably know you most for this mumble.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's true.
Does anybody come up to you ahead and say, "Hey, you're the guy that mumbles"?
That happens regularly, actually. Less so today than it did before, and that kind of changed. You know, we do a little less of it today because we've allowed ourselves, people voted on a constitutional amendment a number of years ago that allows us to waive reading for very large bills. So we don't see the extended periods of time like we used to do where we'd read for 7 or 8 hours at a time. But, you know, people recognize that. I always tell them, yeah, I know I do that, but I've got 300 other things going on in my mind when I'm doing that, you know. So, but it just part of the job.
Does it? You ever mumble in your sleep?
I not that I know of. I don't practice in my sleep that I know of.
You don't practice.
No.
Was that ever a concern? I mean, that would seem to me like that would be the worst part of the job.
It is. Was it a concern? No, you just knew it was there. You had to do it, you know. So you try and develop a skill that allows you to do it as quickly and painlessly as possible. It was an important part of the Constitution at one time. I think it's less so now simply because, you know, there was a reason for that requirement, and that was to allow members the one time that they're alone with their thoughts on the floor, not being bothered by staff or lobbyists or other members, to reflect on what they were about to do, cast that final vote on something. And so there was value in that. Now, whether or not it's as valuable today, I'm not sure, as it was, say, 20 years ago. Yeah.
Going back to your persona, I should say, people have said you're not a very good poker. You wouldn't make a very good poker player.
I think that's true. I'm not a good poker player. If I'm unhappy about something, usually people will know. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. But that's okay. You know, I think that's part of my job, you know. Yeah, and sometimes.
When you reflect back on, you know, your time and your, some people will say you have been the keeper of the institution. There was George Norris, and then there was you.
They're very kind, the people that say that. I'm a great admirer of George Norris. He did, you know, it was unfortunate because he was at one time declared to be one of the five greatest United States senators. And I've always admired him. I obviously never had the opportunity to meet him. I wish I had. But his vision, I think, has served Nebraska really well. I know the institution today is different, and the people in it are different, and there are different attitudes about some of it. But I, as I have traveled around the country and seen other legislatures operate, I can honestly tell you and your public, your viewing public, that this nonpartisan unicameral thing that we have here works well for Nebraska. We make mistakes like every state legislature makes mistakes, but I also think the legislature has done a tremendous job of serving the public, figuring out how to solve problems, move the state forward, and we've done it without the bitter partisanship that you've seen in other places. I mean, we're seeing more of that today, as you know, in our body. I wish that weren't true. I'm hopeful that the pendulum will swing back to a more moderate conversation, a moderate tone. But we'll see, you know. But I think Nebraskans have a right and should be proud of what this legislature has looked like, how it's operated. I think it served the public interest very well.
You know, some people say, you know, you get here, you know, you kind of are just fading away. Is that by purpose? You know, there's no, you didn't do it, you know, you didn't say you were retiring so you could have a big, all these senators come up and say things and things like that. They usually do at the end of the stuff and you have a big, you know, speech and stuff like that.
I never wanted the place to be about me. I'm fortunate to have found this position, and I think I've been able to contribute in some ways. But the place is never about me. It's never about an individual member. I wrestled with that, to be honest with you, but I'm very content with how I'm walking out. I feel like we've been able to do some good things here, and I'm proud of what we've accomplished. And when I say we, I'm talking about my team. So I feel good about that. All those nice accolades. I'm getting nice notes all the time now, and that means as much to me as if I had the opportunity to address the body on the last day of session or something. So,
what would you tell lawmakers in the future?
Protect the place. It's easy to ridicule, make fun of, attack, especially if you're not getting your way. But legislatures generally and legislative assemblies generally were designed to provide a forum for, you know, differences to be resolved and worked out and come to consensus. And that's why I said earlier to you, this legislature, I think, has done a really remarkably good job of doing that. Last few years have been a little more difficult, but I think this legislature has always tried to move to a consensus to accomplish some policy goal, and I'm pleased to have been part of that.
Last question is, your best day, and your, let's go the worst day in the legislature.
Worst day?
The worst day and the last and the best.
Worst day, you know, it's hard to know. I mean, the day Jerry Warner died and we found out we were in session, that was a difficult day. Not because of what was going on, but just because he was no longer there, going to be with us. I don't like it when members attack the institution, you know. And that happens from time to time. Almost in any session, you're going to see one or two of those things. So I don't know if I have a worst day scenario. There have been a number of hard days, you know. Good days are when we accomplish something, we get something done. I'm reminded, I always enjoy, of any two-year cycle, I always enjoy the first day of a new legislature, so January 4th in 2023, for example. Because it's an exciting time, you're electing new leadership, people are going to lead for the next 2 years. So that's always a fun day. It's always kind of bittersweet at the end of the second year when members get up and say goodbyes, you know. And I always find it interesting because those speeches, those farewell speeches, are sometimes the best speeches that member ever gave on the floor. You know, I mean, because they're starting to realize that they were part of something now, and they really didn't appreciate that before. So that's always been, I always enjoyed that day, listening to members' own reflections on what serving meant to them. So there's been a lot of good days. I mean, you meet a lot of really wonderful, wonderfully dedicated public servants here. And I have great admiration for those that have served. No, that's great.
That was perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think I'm going to...
eight session, and something was going on, and I turned around to Jerry, and he said, Pat, come here. And I said, yes, sir. He said, well, he said, you know what? You know what you're doing. I started acting like it. Best advice I ever got in the place, you know? And he was right. And so when you asked me about a presence, I think that's kind of the start of that, you know? And, you know, sometimes you just have to, act like you know what you're doing, and then hope like hell it was the right thing to have done. And luckily, most of the time it was. So.